this time of desperation. When all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, we believe in this broken generation. Dark, you help us. And there is only one salvation. We believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ.
We believe in the resurrection. is coming in, and I would ask you to respect their decision. Again, I would ask for complete order of this hearing. No screaming, shouting. Let's keep this very civil. Let's not allow it to become into a circus. Foreman, would you like to stand, please? The defendants, you've been charged with a crime. I would appreciate if you'd please stand for the verdict. You may read the verdict.
We have, Your Honor, in the case against Simon Peter and John, son of Zebedee, we find the defendants not guilty.
Whoa! Please, quiet. Quiet in court.
Jesus of Nazareth's body was not stolen. He really has risen.
Quiet! Todd, would you please, Mr. Bailiff, would you release these prisoners? We thank you, people of the court, for the ones that have been patient. We thank you, the jury, for your decision. And we honor that. And this includes the case 97012 of the court. And we thank you very much. Court.
Amen, amen. Greet your neighbor this morning and tell him that God is not dead.
Revival. Let heaven roar and fire.
Let no one caught in sin remain inside the lies of inward shame, but fix our eyes upon the cross and run to Him who showed great love and bled.
That You would just fill this place. Everything we are, everything we have is You. Pour out Your Spirit in this place today. Pour out Your Spirit in this place today. We give You praise and glory. We thank You for the Son. We thank You for the unconditional love. Lord, I ask this be a day that we just recognize that love You have for us. Lord, I want to see this chains broken. Too many in here in this place that have walked in this morning and said, just have felt unloved or felt unworthy. We need a hero in our lives. That is you. Life today, that's what we're celebrating. Amen. He was restored. The day is just like that. Today is your chance for resurrection. Today is your chance for spiritual resurrection. That's the beauty about this. is that you can find, all look around this whole church, and you can look and find many, many people that can tell you that I once was dead. And now I'm found. Now I'm alive. I once was lost. Amen. I once was blind. The key word there being once. I pray that if you do not know Jesus Christ today, that you do not leave this place. That you do not leave this place. You cannot leave this place. And maybe you know Jesus. Maybe you've wandered off like we all have. Today is your day of resurrection. Today is your day of resurrection.
Restore us, Lord, and lift us up. We praise you. Oh, we praise you. Restore us, Lord, and lift us up. Oh,
God's in the restoring power. Amen. I'm going to tell you right now, He doesn't just restore, He resurrects. And I'm going to tell you, no matter where you're at today with God, no matter if you're at a place, and I know this is not the customary time that we probably plan on doing this, but I'm going to tell you, if you're in the place where your faith needs to be resurrected today, I challenge you to come up here. I challenge you to say, God, if you're really real, if you're really real, if you did what you said you did, Father, restore me. Resurrect my faith that once was there. Resurrect me where I was once on fire, and now I'm not, and I don't know what to do. Because I'm going to tell you right now, listen to me. God is in the resurrection business. He resurrects things. He restores back what was lost. Come on. He restores back what was lost. Whatever the devil has taken from you and brought down on your family, I want to tell you right now, God says, I'll get it back for you. I'll get it back, but you got to trust in me. You got to keep going, just like the disciples had to keep going that next day. I want to let you know, you got to keep going. You got to keep going.
Restore us, love. He lives you up and restore us. risen King,
the risen King.
Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. Sing it for the glory of the risen King.
Savior, he can move the mountains. Our God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. And conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Singing.
God has just told me to give my brief testimony. Look, I used to be in drugs. I used to be in sexual sin. And I started going to church, and I got saved, and I didn't really get changed. Till the power of the Holy Spirit fell on me one day. And he's welcome to all you guys. He wants you guys to know that he's willing to come into your life. You got to ask for it. See, God's just sitting there at the open door. He's saying, behold, I hold the door. Come in. You all are welcome. The Holy Spirit is available to all y'all. I join you guys. Hit the altars. Come up here and get God right now. This is the day of your salvation. Don't wait. Don't wait no more. Time to get alive, church. You may come here for Easter church, but this is real church. Come out here every day. Ask God to come into your life. The Holy Spirit. He's taken me from the grave. He's brought me back to life. He can do the same for you guys.
Thank you.
life's hard, but you know, God's brought me through it. By God's grace, I met Jamie and Sam, and it just led me on my heart to come up here and just tell you, never give up. Perseverance, and you know, I ain't really good on speaking the mic, but I just thank you. God has laid tough on my heart. I posted it up on Facebook. You know, every day in your life, if you ain't grateful for every day of your life, you probably miss a few like I have. You know, I've missed a lot of holidays, a lot of days. The last 8 months of my life, I've turned my life around. I brought my family to church. God has stepped up my life. I mean, I've just been beaten. I have been beaten. But if you don't believe in God, just take me for granted. Look at me. Look what I've been through in my life. I'll tell you what, God's moved. He's been moving. And he's still moving.
Thank you.
to hang on with God today. You want a good reason to say, I got to stay with it. I can't drop out. I can't be a deadbeat Christian. I got to stay on track, even if it costs me everything. If you need any reason at all to hang on, then look at my brother Jerry. I'm going to tell you, I believe with all my heart, had Earl and Linda quit on God, had we just set out on God and said, God, we're going to put you back on second or third base in our life. If we quit serving and we just quit everything and said, I just want to sit still and do nothing. I'm going to tell you right now, I can guarantee you with 100% fact that my brother Jerry, after the last 8 months, would not be standing on this stage saying, I'm going to tell you, if you don't like holidays, try missing a few. Easter after Easter and birthday after birthday and his daughter's birthday and all this stuff coming and going, my brother's sitting in a jail cell for something like 14 years and begging God, do something. And God says, stay the course. God, do something. Stay the course, Earl. God, you got to move. Stay the course, Earl. God, you got to do something. Stay the course, Earl. See, everything revolves around you doing the right thing because you don't know how it's going to affect somebody's life that could be sitting in a jail cell right now. Right now, I'm going to tell you, back on Monday, my brother was back there preaching the gospel last Monday morning, and I was like, somebody needs to record this. He's up there saying, I was in jail. Look at me. I was a thief. I was doing heroin. I was doing drugs. I wasn't here for my family, and everybody should have disowned me. But God has set me free. God has set me free. Folks, listen to me. It's Easter, and we're so glad you're here. But it's time to get real with God. It's time to get real. Either these disciples and Jesus was absolutely crazy, or Jesus really meant when he said, if you want to be my disciple, you have to deny yourself. When Matthew got up and Peter walked away from all that they had going on and all the disciples, and that was the model of the ministry. That is the model of the ministry. There is no plan A. Forsake everything else and pick up your cross and follow him. Happy Easter. We got a risen Savior. We got one that changes lives of brothers that were sitting in jail. There is hope today. You have a hope today. If you don't have any more hope, I want to tell you, find hope in the lives changed. Because that's what I'm clinging to, me, myself, and my brother and my family. You may be seated. I'm going to tell you, it took about everything in me not to Melissa Russet this morning and just take off smack running right around this place and just saying, God, I'm amazed at what you're doing. I'm amazed. And I'm going to tell you right now, all the 12 disciples of Melissa would have been right behind you, honey. As soon as they realized Jesus was out of that tomb, there ain't a thing that could have kept them. I mean, it says Peter ran as fast as he could to the tomb to find it empty. I do believe that whatever it takes to serve God with all your heart, you should do that. Whatever it takes to keep him right on first base. God, you're going to be first in my life. Do that. Don't come in here thinking we're going to entertain you for a moment and we'll see you next year, because I'm going to tell you, you're headed to hell if that's what you really think. He is not an Easter kind of God. He's a 24/7, I want to affect your life kind of God. Amen? That's what kind of God we serve. He wants to be interactive every single day in our life. He will not play second, and he will not play third base. You will play going to hell. God says, I want to be first. Seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added to you. Because we have a good God. Amen. Let's pray for the offering. God, we come before you right now. God, we thank you for this offering. It's getting ready to be taken up. God, I thank you because of who the people we have sitting in here, the ones that are givers, the ones that even ain't givers, God, but they're saying, you know what, I'm trying to get to that place. God, I ask you to bless them. God, we know, God, just from evidence of what's happening, that, God, you are moving and you are changing lives right now. God, we've seen it firsthand this week where we've seen somebody that was on the streets go to an apartment. We've seen somebody that was restored this week because of faithful people in this church. Amen. 3 days. Amen. That's all it took for Jesus to be resurrected too. God, I thank you, God, that you're meeting needs. Not just that need, but you're meeting other needs. You're meeting gas needs, and you're meeting rent needs, and gas and electric needs, and food needs, God. And it's all these resources that are coming together, God, because you are who you are in our life. God, I thank you. I could not thank you enough, God, for changing my life. I could not thank you enough, God, for what you're doing in everybody's life in here. So, God, I ask you to bless this offering. Multiply it, God, so we can keep doing your work in your kingdom, God, and changing lives. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said,
where to stand in the morning, and who told the ocean you can only come this far, and who showed the moon where to hide till evening, whose words alone can capture fall.
Amen. And that was awesome. Our Redeemer lives. Amen. Amen. Today, me and Earl are just going to speak for probably 5 minutes apiece and just tell you the number one reason why we know the resurrection is true. Why we know. What's the number one evidence that the resurrection is really true? Because, and I shared it in the 9 a.m. service, and I've been thinking about it all week as I was reading. There's really only two options throughout all of history. Not according to Scripture. History and Scripture. There's only two options for what you can believe. Either Jesus resurrected from the dead or the disciples stole his body. That's it. That's not just Scripture. That's history. Jesus did resurrect from the dead. Why? What's the number one reason I know that Jesus resurrected from the dead? And I want to tell you, here's the number one reason that I know that Jesus resurrected from the dead. It's because, and God knew what I was going to speak about. God knew what I was going to say. And he brought three people up here to give their testimony just to back up what I'm saying. And he did. Because here's the number one evidence that Jesus is not in the tomb and that he's living. It's that the people, they used to be one way, and then God has changed them, and they've been resurrected, and they're not that way anymore. Amen. That is the best evidence. That is the best evidence. You can look at Simon Peter. Look at his life. That before the resurrection, he denied Jesus 3 times. After the resurrection, he was crucified on a cross just like Jesus. You can look at Andrew. You can look at all the disciples. Before Jesus was resurrected, they lacked some faith, just like we all do. After the resurrection, when they saw that risen Savior, they didn't lack faith anymore. They were bold. They were willing to preach no matter what. They were changed through the resurrection. And as you saw through testimonies, we can still be changed through the resurrection of Jesus right now, today. God wants to change you. He wants to change me. And it's a process. And he's going to change us over the course of time. And our faith is going to grow. And we're going to grow. And you're going to see that change. And that's the number one evidence that Jesus still lives. It is. But the greatest person to ever show this in Scripture, the greatest example of Christ's resurrection in all of Scripture is Saul. Or Paul, whatever you want to call him. The greatest example. You think Jerry Breeden went to jail a lot, or you think Jerry Breeden was bad? Saul was way worse. You think you're bad? Saul was 10 times worse. You think you've sinned a lot against God? Saul was 10 times worse than you. He didn't just sin against God, he murdered Christians. And then he became the most bold apostle to ever live on the face of the planet. Now you tell me there's not a risen Savior. You look in Acts chapter 8, Saul is tearing up the church. He's killing thousands and thousands of Christians. He's tearing up the church. He even stones one of Jesus' apostles right there in Acts chapter 7. He stones Stephen. He's right there. Some even believe that the thorn in Paul's flesh was the fact that he actually stoned Stephen. That he could never get that out of his mind. You see, the truth is, Paul was an awful person. Paul was, according to Christians, Paul was the worst of the worst, and he admits that all throughout his books that he wrote. But the number one example of the resurrection of Jesus is the Apostle Paul. Jesus really did rise from the dead because Jesus met him on that Damascus road. He didn't just meet him in a little way. He met him in a divine encounter on that road where he blinded him, spoke to him, and then he led him to the city where someone would heal him, and then he would go preach the gospel throughout all the nations and to me and you as Gentiles. Me and you would not be where we're at right now if it wasn't for the Apostle Paul. You wouldn't know Jesus right now if it wasn't for the Apostle Paul. The same man who killed thousands of Christians is the same man that led you to Jesus. Look in Acts chapter 9, and this scripture is not going to be up on the screen, but in Acts chapter 9, you see him. He's changed. It says, for some days, this is verses 19, starting at 19 through like 24. For some days, he was with the disciples at Damascus, and immediately he proclaimed Jesus in the synagogue, saying, he is the Son of God. You see that? Saul went from who he was, and then he met Jesus on that Damascus road, and immediately he started preaching that Jesus was the Son of God. Immediately, when he met Jesus, he started preaching that Jesus was the Son of God after killing Christians for years. Now think about that. I'm going to tell you, when you really meet Jesus, you'll start preaching he's the Son of God immediately. Trust me, it's happened in my own life. As all those people were giving their testimony, I was thinking about mine. You know what? I've lived in a Christian home my whole entire life, but I never met Jesus until a little boy came up to me in the DR, Dominican Republic, and he held on to me for 2.5 hours. And when I met Jesus, I started preaching immediately. I'm telling you. I remember I was in the DR, and that little boy came up to me and held on to me, and that's where I met Jesus. When Jesus says you can meet him in the least of these, he means it. And the little boy, special ed, lots of needs, couldn't really walk, just held his arms up, grabbed him, held on to me for 2.5 hours. That's Jesus to me. And I met him there. And then immediately as I got home, I came up in front of the church and I said, I'm supposed to be the youth pastor here. Started preaching right then. It didn't happen 50 days later. It didn't happen a year later. It happened immediately. Immediately. I'm going to tell you, when you meet the Son of God, when you meet Jesus, and you meet his resurrection, and you really know that he lives, and I hope that today is that day, and my prayer is that today is that day for you, you'll start preaching he's the Son of God, and your life will never be the same. That is the number one evidence that Jesus Christ still lives today. Amen.
Amen. How do you follow that? You know, I was sitting there and I was listening to Josh and I was thinking, that is so true about lives changing. Because my life has changed and most people around me that's been affected by Christ, their life has changed. And I do get that and it's so true, but here's what I would think would be the most compelling thing about Jesus rising is because I preached in the 9 o'clock service. This morning, and it was Psalms 22, was told 1,000 years before the time that Jesus went to the cross, before the time that the cross crucifixion was ever even invented, that God had done set a plan and a course that David had no clue when he wrote the Psalms 22, that the very first line would be, my God, why have you forsaken me? And the last line of Psalms 22 would say, he has done it. And I'm going to tell you, that's pretty compelling, 1,000 years before he done it. And all through Psalms 22, it tells about Jesus going to the cross, that he would be mocked, he would be bruised, he would be thirsty, and they would pierce his hands and his feet. And then they come up on an empty tomb, and all of a sudden everybody's surprised and thinking, this is not true. And I'm going to tell you, we have a world that is so set on one thing, is they want to see it to believe it. And I'm going to tell you, God's word is true because he demonstrates it just like Josh said. He demonstrated it then, and he demonstrates it now. One of the things that I think that compels me is that Jesus, had it all been a lie, like I was trying to convince the jurors earlier, had it all been a lie, why did Jesus appear in the same town and preach to the same people that put him on the cross? Why did he appear to over 500 people? Why didn't, if it was all going to be a lie, why didn't the disciples run away from the towns where they would be known? If you were really going to try to pull off the greatest lie to ever known to man, what you would do is you would grab that lie and you would run miles and miles away where everybody doesn't know everybody like they knew people then, like they know people in Grant County. Something's going on in Grant County, it's just like yesterday's news. Everybody knows about it. Hey, did you hear about this? And I was like, no, I didn't hear about it. Well, let me tell you. I'm like, I don't even care. Like, I don't care why so-and-so's bread maker don't work because that's why she called in and she really wasn't sick. And I mean, that's how it was. So if it was a lie, if it was the greatest lie ever known to change the entire world and the disciples really did steal the body, and if he was really dead, why did they preach in the same towns that put him on the cross? Why did they boldly stand in front of people and say, he has did what he said he would did and what he said he would do? And not only that, he cooked his breakfast. Jesus showed up and preached to over 500 people multiple times. Folks, we have a risen Savior We have a God that does something. But I was sitting there and I was looking at this picture. And I want to tell you, the picture's wrong. As nice as this picture looks, and it shows a little dove up there, and it shows that the cloth is not there and his body's gone, the scripture says that at the head of the tomb where he would have been laying, that there was a nicely folded cloth laying there. And it's not in this picture. So technically, scripturally, that's not right. But why some people would say, why would you bring that up? And here's, now I know there's arguments over this, so don't come and tell me, I don't know if that's true. Here's what it's been said. From the Roman cultures and the Roman studies that have been said about the people and the people that were rich, the people that were kings, what they would do is they would sit down and eat, and the servants would come in and serve them, and they would have a napkin or a cloth that they would have, and what they would do is they would eat. Now, if the king got up for any reason, and the servants would watch the king to know when we could clear the table, then what would happen is the king, when he would get up, if he was coming back, what he would do is he would nicely fold the cloth, and he would lay it right there where he would sit, and that would let the servants know that the king is coming back. If he would just take the cloth and throw it down on the plate and it was not nicely folded, that means the servants could come in because the meal was done. It was over. There would be no more eating there at the table. And I do believe 100%, without a shadow of a fact, what Jesus was trying to say then is, first off, I am the king and I'm coming back, baby. I'm coming back. And I think that when the disciples went in there and they saw that, that would be forever ringing in Scripture, that why would Jesus take the time to fold a cloth and lay it in there as if it didn't mean anything? Don't you know why? Because it ain't over till it's over. This world may have given up on Jesus, but I'm going to tell you, when the Bible says he's coming soon, he's coming back, prepare. Live as if there's no tomorrow. Live for today. Because listen, don't worry about tomorrow. It's got enough problems for itself. And he says, hey, coming back. And it's going to be seem like a short time, trust me. He's coming back, folks. I want you to be ready. Can everybody stand up and the band come on back up here? I want you to be ready today. You don't know him, and you're saying, I don't know this Jesus you're talking about, and maybe you do know him, and maybe it's time today on Easter Sunday to say, I know, well, you know, I wish maybe I'd have stayed home. All these people, and it's a little too, hey, you know what? It ain't about these people. It ain't about this building. It's about you, and it's about God. Stop playing, church. Stop playing and let God really do something in your life. Stop acting like, you know what, you got it all figured out, because I'm going to tell you, I don't have it all figured out. I'm still learning, and God's still showing me scriptures every day that I didn't have a clue. But it's time, church. It's time to get a little radical for Jesus and start changing lives like the disciples changed lives. And stop doing some of the things. Listen, we have an overcoming. We have a forgiving. We have a loving God. He's a graceful God. He's a merciful God. He will do all things and anything to get your attention. And today, what he wants you to know is that he loves you very much. Amen.
You know, I sit back there and I contemplated whether I should come up here. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Randy Russ. And I would ask that you pray for me today. If you don't know me, pray anyway. I'm at a very dark point in my life. My life's a mess. I love all of you. Pray for me.
Splendor of the King.
in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice, and all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light. Darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice.
Day. We thank you for being able to stand here and praise you, Lord. We thank you for all that you've done for us. We thank you for this day of celebration. Lord, asking you continue to lead and guide and direct us in all that we do. Be with us as we visit our families today, as we head to our homes. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. We love you all.